I'm Aki Kareem, this is BBTV's new weekly boxing show, Boxmania, and I've got the pleasure of being joined by Mr. Robbie Davies Jr. right here. We've got his promoter and manager, Mr. Neil Marsh, and of course we've got John Evans here. Now, first things first, you've got a fantastic record. 13 fights, 9 by knockout. You're the WBA Continental Champion. Yeah. You're ranked 6 with WBA, yeah. Is that right?
And climbing.
5 in Britain, and climbing. Rank yeah. 5 in Britain?
5 or 6, I'm not sure.
And you're also...
Going by box rec,
yeah. And you're also, I hear, a massive cinema geek as well, which we'll come on to later. So firstly, being 13 and 9, you've obviously got some serious power.
Yeah, it's got better as I've got older. As an amateur, basically me, I was always a back foot fighter, and then progressed as my later years in the amateurs started stopping people, and then... found me late power as I started turning professional, putting the little gloves on, and then a white guard.
Yeah. You're known for being a power puncher. What actually do you think makes a power puncher, and what...
If you were to ask me, I'd say speed and timing. Yeah. But if you were to ask to compare the both, I'd always pick timing over speed.
Yeah. And you've got, how many first round knockouts is it now?
Eight. I'm not sure.
Eight. And we're talking about ironclad chinned fighters that are granite chins, and you're taking them out.
Yeah, well... Yeah. Looks that way.
Watch out for this power. In fact, talking of serious power, this reminds me of a masterclass which I went and did at Collier's and Moston Gym with none other than Mr. Mark Heffron, the Dynamite Kid. Let's have a look at it. I'm Aki Kareem. I'm here with BBTV. This is the new boxing show. It's coming to you. I'm here with Mr. Mark Heffron, the Dynamite Kid. He's got a serious record. I think it's 11 fights with 9 KOs. He's undefeated, he's on the tail of all the boys at 160, and he's here today to do a little masterclass with us, and the masterclass is going to be on the right hand, the power shot. So firstly, like, you're a massive power puncher.
Yeah.
Where have you naturally got power, or have you is that something you've developed, or have you just always had it since you were young?
Yeah, well, I've always had it since being young, but I do work on shots and that.
Yeah. Alright, nice. Well, we're gonna see how to land like this big right hand here. So what sort of things would you suggest when you're trying to land that big right hand knockout shot?
Well, you just twist your body into the shot.
Yeah? Yeah?
Twist into it.
Alright, so in terms of footwork, your back foot is you're driving everything through. Yeah. Alright, can you show us on here? One more, then my wrist is gonna fall off. I'm telling you now, seriously, you have to come down here and experience that, because that my whole body and arm is shaking it from that right hand. So if you throw that right cross though, it's you have to commit quite a lot. Like, how can you make sure that you're aware of what's coming back at the same time, or is it just like a gambling shot?
It's like a gambling shot. Yeah. Obviously, that's what we work anywhere. So like events and getting out of the way of shots and. Countering, stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, if anyone gets hit with that...
I'm always ready for someone to punch back.
Yeah. So, I mean, is there anything you just... Can you throw another shot on top of that right? Like, if you throw that right cross, what's the natural shot that comes next?
Really, let's go for that.
Oh, can we just get a little... Let me just... Come in here. Yeah. Right, okay. So, we'll go for 2 power shots here. The big right hand and the big left hook to follow it. We might have to stop there because my hands are insured for like 5 million each. But that's a serious power. Do you let your power go early, or do you like to sort of like break your opponents down a little bit first? What's the best thing for you?
I try to break them down first, but with the majority of the fights, it stops in the first round.
How many have you had in the first round now?
About 8.
8 in the first round, and seriously, I can understand why, because if you get hit with that, you're going to sleep. And as you can see there, he's got power to burn. Both of you, power punches. How does a back foot fighter transition into being a come forward fighter who's a knockout artist?
I don't know. I think generally when I first started boxing as an amateur, I was all gun go blazing anyway. But then the way the computer scoring changed, and you had to land on the white dot and you had to hit the target. You had to have space to get the clean shots in. So I used to prefer fighting like that. And then as you turn professional, you see like the way the aggressor and work rate and all them come into account for taking a 10-9 round. I like altered and just went back to my old way, and then I was still using like a bit slipper than lateral movement.
Yeah.
But then when you start landing in the little gloves, obviously you have a bigger effect.
Yeah.
And I was shocking myself at first.
Yeah. No, the power's not going to help you get these fights, is it, Robbie? You know, if you speak to anyone around the country who's seen you spar, seen you fight, they all put you down as someone to watch. And it seems to be now people putting you down as someone to avoid. It's proving tricky to get that fight that's going to prove you more than a prospect and a genuine title threat, isn't it?
I know the fight's what we want, and sometimes Neil will even tell you, I send him messages of fight, and he laughs his head off as if to say, are you messing? They don't even know you. Why will they want to fight you? And I was like, I'll beat him now.
Well, if you text him the name Mayweather, that's going to happen, isn't it, mate?
No, like the other day, as an example, I was saying to him, I was like, John Molina, he's just beat Provodnikov. Mm. I was like, he's there for the taking, do you know what I mean?
Mm.
Fighters like that, and I was like, and Neil's like, yeah, but you got to wait and things like that. And then we've asked for a few British, like, not lower level, they're probably more higher ranked than me because they've been there and done it. Your Willie Limmons, your Lenny Dawes, people like that.
John Wayne Hibbert.
Yeah, John Wayne Hibbert, he was more known on Sky.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, I had a bit of banter with John because he's full of it, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But then like, what he was saying to me even later in the argument, he was saying, well, Tommy Coyle's a bigger fight for me. I was like, I know what he means, do you know what I mean? Because he's more already established as well. But before the argument, he was saying to us, me and Neil, that it was about family and money and stuff like that.
Mm.
So Neil said, well, whatever they're giving you, we'll give you more.
So then you can see what John says. People looking at your record are going to think, 13 with 9. Why take the risk so early on in our career?
Yeah, high risk, low reward.
Well, it got to a point, Neil, didn't it, where at least one name was on a contract for him. But how complicated do you find it? You're the man who's tasked with matching Robbie. Just how difficult is it?
The British kids, I have made inquiries for all of them.
Yeah.
From Willie Limon to Lenny Dawes.
Yeah.
John Wayne Hibbert. Ashley Fairpain, all of them.
Yeah, yeah.
He's ready for them kids, and I've no doubt that Robbie will give people like Molina an absolute nightmare. But the thing is once you get to that level, it's how long you stay there.
Mm.
When we get there, we're going to stay there.
Mm.
It's hard. There's a lot of politics in boxing, conflicting promoters, conflicting managers. Some kids, like, you know, they think the be all then end all's TV. TV is very important, but the TV is going to come if you're good enough.
Yeah.
And, you know, with John Wayne Hibbert, they disappointed me. We'd had the agreement. They couldn't get a fight off Eddie. And I paid more than TV money. And they took a different one. So his reasons was financially for his family.
Yeah.
So I come in with $7,500 more, which, you know, obviously money wasn't the reason.
Yeah.
The fact is anybody you can punch, and he's done eight of them people in a round, nobody wants to fight him. It's black and white, but, you know, we're well with the WBA, no one's going to stop us getting where we're going.
I'm Aki Kareem, this is BBTV's new weekly boxing show, Boxmania, and you're joining us for Prospect of the Week. I'm here with Marcel Braithwaite, new super, super prospect in the super fly division, and I've got his trainer with us, Mr. Wayne Smith from the Golden Gloves Gym in Liverpool. Now, firstly, Marcel, I've been very interested to meet you because I've been watching some clips of you, and your style is unique. Where did you develop this unique footwork and unique style from?
Basically, myself. I do what feels good. I always have. As long as my coaches have allowed me to express myself, I've put together what feels good for me, and what you see me put on display is what feels good, what looks good, sort of it. So it's a win-win situation for me, really. If it feels good when I do it and then feels good when people watch it, then I'm winning.
Yeah, and we've just watched you do a really good sparring session, some great rounds. You're happy on the outside, you're also happy on the inside. You seem to be quite a complete fighter, you know, even though you're just turning over now, you seem to be quite a complete fighter. Like, what do you make, like, is that something you work, on inside and outside? Where are you more comfortable?
I'm comfy anywhere. I like to be inside, I like to be outside. Wherever the fight goes, I like to be ready. So it's one of them. I just enjoy whatever comes my way and I make the most of it.
You don't care. Inside, outside, he's coming for you regardless. He's not bothered. Wait, let me just bring you in here. Is there anything specific you work on with Marcel? What sort of fighter do you have a vision of him being?
Obviously a champion, innit?
Yeah.
No, as long as he's happy, as I say, a lot of coaches like go military, don't they?
Yeah.
With Marcel, you gotta look at us four here, we're all different, we all look different, we all walk different, we all talk different. Mm. So we're all not going to box the same.
Yeah.
So therefore, you look at a lot of gyms and you know what a lot of fighters, you know what gym they come from.
Yeah.
But with myself and with all my fighters, I like them all to be unique, do themselves, express themselves.
Yeah.
People, someone small like that, they say, I wouldn't be no good on the outside, but it's just
he
a good
is.
On the
seen,
outside.
Yeah, we've seen him there, yeah.
No, I mean, not giving too much away. He's hopefully, everything go all right. He's going to, the long he's going to do all yeah. right.
Now, you've been you sparred with some fantastic fighters. I've had a little look at the people you sparred with, people like Jazza Dickens, Blaine Ireland, Zelfa, you know, our very own Zelfa Brown Flash Barrett, of course. Butler, I mean, you've been in there with some great sparring. How has that given you a lot of confidence?
Yeah, you've got to mix with the best to be the best. I see myself right up there, giving me due time and experience, and I'll be right up there. Yeah, it's good to mix it with them high-level fighters and see where you're at. And as I say, I see myself up there. I enjoy it. And I think Wayne's been happy. Every time I've sparred the big name, he's come away, he's smiling, he's happy with me, we go home happy. So
yeah, nice. Well, I got a little controversial one for you here, because you know that's how I like to bring the party, you know.
Yeah.
Your style's quite flashy, you know, you're quite a confident lad, which is obviously great. Some people are going to absolutely love this style, you know. I'm a fan of this style, right? Some people, though, are going to be like, they're going to be haters, you know. they just are. Are you ready for that? How do you feel about that?
Of course, yeah. I'm not changing for no one. At the end of the day, if I change, it's because I want to change. And at the end of the day, the people who love me, I've got love for them. The people that hate me, that's all good as well. As long as they're talking, as long as it's my name on the lips, it's energy going towards me winning, then it's all good.
Yeah, nice. As long as you don't become an Adrian Broner, that's all good.
Yeah, I know.
And I talk about this situation you got here with training. So obviously we're in Manchester at the minute. We're down at Moston Colliers and Moston Boxing Gym. Also, obviously you're based out of the Golden Gloves in Liverpool. So how does that work? How often are you here and there? How often do you split it between the two?
Well, I'm in Golden Gloves every single day of the week. I come up here 2-3 times a week, usually every morning. So I'm up and down, getting the best of both. And I think it reflects as well in my style. What you've seen before, other people are yet to see in my performances, but I've got 10 days now, so people are seeing.
I mean, you had a great pedigree in the amateurs. You had some great... So tell us a little bit about the sort of titles and sort of accolades you had in the amateurs.
With the amateurs, I won a novice title, which was back in 2013, went straight into the elite ABAs, quarterfinals, semi-finals, Boxer England, in the Three Nations, had two good fights with England. But as you know yourself, as we spoke, I had a lot of bad decisions in the amateurs, some terrible ones, but I'm not one to sit round and cry. I know how good I am, I know how good I can be, so it was time to move on. The amateurs I see is just as an apprenticeship, and now it's time to take that next step. So
and talking about your next step, you're out on the 26th of November in Liverpool on a Black Flash promotion show. Do you know much about your opponent?
Hi, Charlie. No, I know he's going to be a victim.
Yeah.
That's about
it. I've got his name here. It's Amwar Afadili. Afidli? Did you know that?
Yeah,
something like that, yeah.
I know. I've been watching him, obviously. He's a fed
Does he realise what he's in for, Wayne? That's the question.
He's a fed experienced journeyman. He's fought like some good kids. You know, he's been about him. He's had nearly 100 fights.
He's had a lot of fights.
He's had a lot of fights, but he hasn't come up against someone like Marcel. So he's going to be like, oh, he likes to like play the field and knock the goals in. Whatever. But especially the debutants fighters brought it in. We've got a little plan up our sleeve.
Oh, that's cool. I love it when plans are up sleeves. That's the best place to have a plan up that sleeve. Is there anything you want to say out there to anyone who hasn't sort of is not familiar with you, why they should get on board with this journey?
All I can say to everyone is have a little look out for me. If you know you're boxing, if you like entertainment, then I'm the man you want to watch, and I won't disappoint. You see me, and I'm sure you'll be tuning in next time. You'll be waiting to see when that next fight is. And that's what I bring to the table, so let's go.
I know you love him, but you hate him.
Yeah,
I'm 26, still a few tickets left, so.
That's it, that's it. Well, listen, I can't wait for that. And by the way, look at these thighs, built for power. Are we allowed to get close shots on the thighs? Right, there you go. That's the first thing that you had when someone's like. I'm Aki Kareem, this is BBTV's weekly boxing show, Boxmania. I'm here with the prospect of the week. it's Mr. Marcel Braithwaite and his coach and trainer, Wayne Smith.
Cool.
Power. Now, Neil, I mean, in terms of a character working with Robbie, tell people who aren't too familiar with Robbie what sort of a character he's like.
Be gentle.
Be gentle. Yeah, it's a family show.
We've got a very good relationship, but, you know, I'm probably his friend, his manager, everything.
Tell him what he's up to. You can have a cuddle on me. Go on,
no,
what was he dropping off? What was you picking? Because I had a few little niggles, he dropped me a few sports stuff off at my house, but when he was picking it up, we're always having knitting at each other. And then soon he jumps out the van, he grabs me, picks me there, and goes, "You're going in that bin." My street is full of old people. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? You can hear me going, "Put me down! Put me down!"
They'll be on the phone, neighbourhood watch, they'll be on the phone 999 also.
He's got me over his shoulder.
No, he's constantly winding me up. And I think when you're a young man, you're older people, you're always saying, "Oh, I'll do this to you, old man." He calls me granddad and everything, so I just picked him up.
Wait a second, you're not too much of a sprint chicken. You're 27, right? You're coming into your prime.
I'm getting there.
28, 29, that's when a lot of fighters reach their sort of prime years. So are you looking now to push on and in the next few years to really make these sort of the golden years where you go for the bigger fights?
Don't forget, 18 months ago, he was injured. He wasn't getting the fights. And I had to catch up ground. You know, nothing against anyone else in any way, shape or form. The facts is the kid needed to get the right fights.
Yeah.
You know, I brought him Fons Alexander's. I forget the kid, a Georgian kid who'd been in with the likes of Lenny Dawes and that, not really getting stopped that much. And kids who didn't get stopped, then Ryan Harder, and he destroyed them all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we could.
You're talking about Mikhail Avikan then, I think.
Avikan.
Avikan, that's it. And it's easy for you to say.
we had to catch ground, we caught ground quickly.
Yeah.
I had to pick a fight out there, which I could see where Robbie was up to. One, I was confident he could win. I knew Catterall had done 12 rounds, done the distance with Putkinen. Mm-hmm. I knew he was tough, he was coming forward. Mm. It was a really good fight, really tough kid. And I put a decent offer in for him, we got him. And the difference was, and nothing against Jack, I like Jack, he's a nice kid.
Yeah.
In every way. But Jack had so many weeks' notice. You can check on the internet many things. We give Putkinen over 3 months of that fight.
Yeah.
And he came 100% fit.
Yeah.
And Robbie just dismantled him.
Yeah.
And then we went on
what
to...
What round did that one?
Six rounds.
And then we did the Castilla fight.
He'd
done 80% of his sparring with Maidana in Argentina. I knew he could take a good old whack. And he had a lot of notice. And I needed to get him the rounds. I needed to get him experience. So we did a defensive his continental event 6 weeks later.
Robbie was a tremendous amateur. And it's funny you spoke earlier about the power. Yeah. I just wonder if some of this is like subconscious in your mind now to take decisions out of judges' hands. Because I know in your ABA final, the computer system broke and you got a dodgy decision down in London. And then I believe you had a running with a certain well-known Scottish light welterweight who's making some noise at the moment.
Oh, Taylor.
Yeah.
Certain Mr. Josh Taylor.
Yeah. Bumped into him and I beat her. I told him straight then.
Have you got anything to say to him now?
Nah, just if the fight comes up, we're always ready. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Everyone knows that. There isn't anyone in the division where Neil could ring me and I'd go, "Oh, Neil, I don't want to fight him. Or that's a dodgy one." Yeah. It's me ringing Neil and Neil has to say, "Nah, we don't need that one now. We'll wait for that."
Yeah.
That's the order we
go. Gotta get him experience.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. But Neil's doing the right thing with you though. Do you know what I mean? I know you want to be let off the leash, don't you? And
no one in Britain especially, no one fears me. I look at some of the ones the top people are raving over in the world, and I'm looking thinking, I can't see what they see. I don't see the superstardom in that fighter.
Yeah.
I just seen Al Ayman and Top Rank and whoever piling dough into them and making them a superstar.
Just let's talk about when you're next out then. I mean, you're next out, I believe, on the 10th of December.
Yeah,
10th of December. It's one of Neil's shows because before we do go back into the limelight at any sort of level, where I'm going to be back under 12 rounders, while I have had the time off coming away from the title fights and things, I had a few niggles and...
We've tidied them up.
When the Hibbert fight fell through and a few others that wasn't seem to be happening, it was better to, we might as well get rid of them now and come into the new year 100%. Mm-hmm. But then we were thinking, because I got fit so quick, he just literally said, well, as soon as you're fit, you can fight.
Robbie, you know, you're carrying some natural power now, you're fighting as a professional. Your dad was a banger, wasn't he? And Robbie Davies Sr. was a big ticket seller in Liverpool at the old stadium, wasn't he?
Yeah. He was probably the last person to sell the Liverpool stadium out before they got rid of it during probably the late 70s, early 80s.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've heard some stories like over the years.
A big local hero. Robbie's dad boxed in the Olympics, Commonwealth Games medalist as well.
Yeah, he went the Olympics without actually winning even the ABAs. I think, I can't remember, it was a Scottish lad beat him in the ABA final. Because back then it was like England, Scotland and Wales. Mm. The ABAs were all together, where now it's all separate. And he got beat, but then that same fella who beat him in like an international tournament got knocked out cold in the qualifiers and put my dad back in. And Kevin Ickey, I think, was the England coach at the time. My dad always said he loved my dad, let him get away with murder. So threw my dad back in and he ended up going in the 76.
He did.
I'm Aki Kareem, this is BBTV's weekly show Boxmania, and you know what time it is, it's sweet science time. I'm here with the coach, Mr. James Largie at FLF Performance Centre, and we've got a very interesting segment today. Can you tell us what we're going to be talking about today, James?
Today we're going to be discussing ways to reduce hand injuries in the sport of boxing.
Yeah, well, there's quite a few high profile cases of fighters with hand problems and injuries, so obviously we're not going to name any names. So tell us a bit about it then.
So typically when I do the testing, which I've obviously spoke to you before about, I will measure strength, power, speed, agility, quickness, reaction time, all of those key variables. But one of the biggest things that I tend to find in not just professional boxers, amateur boxers, all sorts of fighting sports, is they are very prone to getting hand injuries. And like I mentioned on part one of this Boxmania, nutrition is overlooked massively, but also one of the other key factors that's massively overlooked in boxing is protection of injuries, especially in the hands.
Yeah, okay. And I noticed you've got a little something down there, a little kit. Yep. What's this all about? Tell us about this.
So this is a hand grip strength diameter. This will just give me a number, really, of basically how strong a boxer's hand grip strength is.
Yep.
So what we're actually doing, I've got myself and a undergraduate student from Salford University, is we are testing all of the boxers that now come to the FLF Performance Centre on full grip strength and then individual fingers.
Okay.
That's one assessment measure. So this would be the equivalent of, say, for example, doing a one rep max bench press.
Okay.
And then there's other tests, which is more endurance related test, and that would be the equivalent of doing, for example, a 2 minute push-up test.
Okay.
So we're measuring the same muscle, the same function of grip, but in two different assessments, maximal strength and muscle endurance. So the other tests that you could do, for example, if you don't have one of these at the boxing gym, I would definitely suggest all boxing gyms get one of these, because not only does it tell you how strong your grip strength is, but it'll also tell you how under recovered you are as well. It has a big relation to central nervous system. Mm-hmm. So if you are scoring, say, 56 one day and you score 49 the next day, it's usually a sign to say that you are slightly overtraining.
Okay.
So that's a brilliant piece of kit.
We're always bringing you exclusives here.
Yeah. I mean, we like I say, you don't need to have all of these pieces of kit. There's certain things that you can put into place to improve hand grip strength.
Okay.
Now, hand grip strength, there's loads of studies out there that are in relation to shoulder injuries as well. So how strong your hand grip is will determine whether you're more prone to having rotator cuff injuries, which again is a big, big factor in boxing. There was a study that covered 330 boxing injuries, and a third of them came from this portion here. Right. So it wasn't in relation to the head, the neck.
Yeah.
A third in relation to from the shoulder, elbow, hand and wrist. So these other bits of kit that I tend to use with the boxers, so these are pinch grip test here.
Yeah.
Plate loaded. So I would do this test typically over a distance or for a certain amount of time.
Okay.
So load that up. We've got the ball grip test, which is another great piece of kit. And then we've got this fine piece of kit from Atlantis. So we flew this in over from Canada. And again, this is just to train grip strength, and it'll train it right through the forearm. And then this is a a brilliant test that you can use regardless to what gym you're at. You don't have to be here.
Yeah.
Find a 20 kilo plate and just hold it. The test that we tend to use as a baseline standard is hold this for 20 seconds, 20 kilos for 20 seconds. If you can do that, it tends to be a pass. If you can't do that, we need to work on grip strength. So give that a go.
Here we go. Right. I can't do it for 3 seconds. Wait, I can't do it.
So you've got poor
I can't
grip
do
strength.
It.
So that shows that you are very prone to getting an injured hand.
Yeah.
Especially if you're a strong boxer. And this is something that I brought up with in relation to some of the boxers who got massive amounts of punch power, but they're punching basically with glass hands.
Right.
So no matter how strong or powerful you get, if you're punching with a glass hand, doesn't matter who's wrapping that hand, if you're wrapping glass inside a pillow, there's still potential to smash the glass.
So the whole idea
is to find out if boxers are prone to getting injured, or find out if they already are injured, and if they are, then we can hopefully seal over the cracks.
Fantastic. Those of you that are having a laugh at me right now about that thing, come down and try it first before you start laughing.
They can do it at any gym or at the home.
That's
20 it. 20 kilo plate, hold at the side, stopwatch, 20 seconds, is it good? It's good if it doesn't drop.
Yeah, yeah.
If you can get more than 20, great, even better. That's just one way, there's many ways.
Now, if someone comes to the gym and says to you, listen, I've got some problems with my hands, and they're a fighter, what sort of the first thing you say to them as some preventative measures then?
One of the biggest things that I found today, I was at a boxing gym today, and again, for confidential reasons, I won't mention the person.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing that I tend to find with boxers is because there is constant impact.
Yeah.
There is a built-up of waste product within the forearm. So typically you'll have a lot of fascia tightness, inflammatory around the joint. You get something called tennis elbow or golfer's elbow, so there's usually inflammation around there, a buildup of too much muscle on one side or the other, so there's an imbalance. It really depends on the boxer's style, how they punch, whether they've had a small crack in the bone and then it's increased, whether they've formed callus on the bone, whether you've been out and had a street brawl one day when you was younger and you ended up causing an injury then. There's so many variables to look at, but if I see a boxer with potential for hand injury due to the fact that they've got weak grip strength, then that is something that I'll address straight away, and I'd suggest all boxers to do the same if they want a long career.
Fantastic. Well, I think you'd agree that was a injury. I mean, I've learned something. I've also learned I need to get my grip strength sorted out. So firstly, thanks very much. It's been great coming down here. We love the Sweet Science segment. This is Coach James Largie from FLF Performance Center. I'm Aki Karim, back to the studio. Power. Hi, I'm Aki Karim. I'm reporting here for British Boxers website, and I'm here with a new prospect we're going to introduce today. It's Ricky Starkey, who goes by the name of the Battalion Stallion. Now, first things first, Ricky, what weight division are you in?
Between Bantam and Feather, so probably about Super Bantam.
About Super Bantam, all right. And tell us a little bit about like your background. I understand you're ex-military.
Yeah.
And you just told me off camera an amazing story about you actually got blown up.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, went over to Iraq on the 11th of November 2006 up until June 2007. Whilst I was over there, it was Mars Bertie when I'm out there on Remembrance Day, and then had me 21st over there. 5 days later, I got blew up by a command wire. I went off underneath the warrior. I was the gunner in the turret. It knocked us all out, and then we had to get the QRF to come and pick us up and take us back to the Chateau Hotel, which was still open at the time before it got closed.
Yeah, man. I mean, do experiences like that make the fight game easy in a way, because you've been through something like that? Does it for you make the fight game a bit easier?
Well, let's be honest, I mean, you know, it's probably the closest I'm going to come to dying unless somebody catches me with a heavy shot in that, but you know, I've got no intention of getting caught with any of them if I can help it.
Yeah. All right, tell us a little bit about your background in boxing then. When did you start out boxing? Like, what's the story with that?
Well, one of my mates from school, a lad called John Reynolds, he got me into it. I started at the St. Teresa's Club in Norris Green. They had coaches Paul Allen, Danny Redden, and Mick and Joe McVeigh. Had a couple of fights for them, joined the army, done the last one Kings into companies, first two ranks into companies, individuals in between, getting called up for the army team since 2006, got released in 2009 eventually, went to box for the army in 2009, a triple combat service champion at novice level. They got out the army, done a few unlicensed ones in between and after I got out, and then I boxed for the Solly, done the Allengay Box Cup twice, went in for the ABAs once as well, and well, turned over, and now I'm with John Smith, Smogger. He's also an ex-Kingo.
Yeah.
I've actually come out to my regimental song when I'm fighting, so all the lads are singing when I come out. It's a bit like a football chance.
Nice. So you've got a good following then, for people that come out to see you and that?
Well, I think I've had about 50 or so for like for the first couple that I've had at Robin Park. I had two in there. Gave away £8.5 in my first fight. The lad was meant to come in at 9.6 and he turned up at 9.10.5 yeah. on the day. I only found out he was fighting the night before because the original opponent pulled out with 2 weeks to go. Right. And then just recently boxed for FI though. Wasn't the best fight for me, to be honest, it was more of a hugging match, but I think probably my work rate that got me. Could have gone either way, to be honest, though. He's a tough kid and, okay. you know.
Now, in the pros, you're currently 2-0, is that right, yeah?
Yeah.
Now, when are you next out? So when can people see you actually next out in a pro bout?
Saturday the 3rd of December at Lee Sports Village.
Okay.
It's just near Wigan, by the Centurions ground, off the M57.
All right. And guys, listen, you got to follow this story. You got to get with it. I mean, you know, you seem like a great character. You've got a great backstory. I know you're hungry for success.
Yeah.
For those people that aren't familiar with you out there, why should they get behind you?
Well, I'm a military veteran, and obviously, like, you know, it stands for a lot. I'm coming out to my regimental song for a reason, because it's got a lot of history behind it. Mm. A lot of people actually died. That song's been going right through the Battle of the Somme. Lads been, you know, singing that, going over the top while you were, like, getting shot and blew up and dying and that in the wars. And, you know, got a lot of time for the older veterans and stuff. I'm always trying to make the effort to go to all the reunions, meet up with all the lads, reminisce about the old times, and if there's anything I can do to help any of them, and likewise, you know, vice versa, and that, then I'm more than happy to do that, because at the end of the day, the army's sort of like a family, and it's a sort of a brotherhood, especially with the Kingos.
Listen, guys, there you go. I mean, seriously, you want to get behind this guy. This is Ricky, the Battalion Stallion Starkey, and he's coming for you. He's 2-0. Let's get that 3-0. He's out on the 3rd of December. You don't want to miss it. Power.
So just talking about some big fights that are coming up, especially some that might be relevant to you guys. We've got Thurman Garcia coming up. That's a big fight. Now, I want to get you guys' opinions. I want to get the expert opinions on this. We'll start with you, Robbie.
I'm going with what we said earlier. I'm going with Garcia because he always finds a way.
Man. Garcia always finds
that
a way.
That would be me.
But I completely disagree.
Right.
I've flown out to New York to watch the Thurman Porter fight.
Yep.
And I thought pressure, you could get to Thurman.
Mm.
The guy, I know, there's not much difference with watching TV to ringside.
Mm.
The guy's a class act, and I think he murders Garcia.
Okay.
I think he'll stop him. I think he'll stop him comfortably. I don't see it in a difficult fight for Thurman. I think it's the right fight financially, okay. But I don't see it.
I'm the same. I think one time special. I think he's got that certain something. Well, the division, welterweight's the biggest division, and it's crying out for a star, and it's one time.
And you think it's one time?
I think it's one time.
Who laboured to win against Leonard Bundu? That one time.
Who got smashed? Who got smashed in four rounds by Errol Spence? I think if you picked a welterweight out of all of them, you'd go with Errol Spence.
Oh no, Errol Spence. All there, definitely.
I'd go with Garcia over Thurman just because he always finds a way. He's very he throws punches in the exchange, and Thurman likes to exchange. Garcia left hook out of the exchange.
Yeah,
I think he's going to chin him.
That is the one shot though. I think Thurman will know. To stay away from
Thurman's got a better left hook than
Garcia. Yeah, but he throws a right hand lead the whole time. The right hand lead, the counter is the left hook over the top.
Garcia is like left hook though. He's looking at his shoe when he throws it. Do you know what I mean? It's just woof, and if it hits anything, it's going to sleep.
Anything's going to sleep.
Thurman adapt to different situations, especially the Porter fight.
Yeah, but look at Garcia in the Matisse fight. Everyone thought Matisse was going to come in and knock him spark out. And he didn't school him, but he really unlocked him.
And it was a lifetime ago. Wasn't it?
I don't think Matisse is Thurman. I don't think Matisse.
But then you see Matisse again. Okay, well, exposed by Postel.
Yeah.
And Postel wasn't great, was he? He just had
He did break his orbital bone with a shot, though, didn't he? And you can't fight with a broken orbital bone, can you?
But he was winning the fight anyway. Do you know what I mean? And it was like them sort of fighters, with the same fighters that have been exposing Matisse over the years, do you know what I mean?
Well, okay, what about Garcia? I mean, he's taken out Khan, he's taken out Peterson as well. Peterson was a close fight, of course, but he's taken out some big names. Who's Thurman taken out, apart from Porter, that's on that level?
Guerrero.
You think Guerrero's on the level of...
Guerrero wasn't at his best, though.
No.
Guerrero's been not on his best for a bit, has he?
Robert Guerrero, if we're looking at names at certain levels on the decline, on people on the way up, Robert Guerrero's a
perfect example.
I've done the Guerrero fight for Avanesian,
yeah.
But then he got beat. So the girl out of fight went out the window.
It got beat by a stablemate, the Castillo wife.
Yeah, in Argentina.
They had the same shorts on. It must be like a brand short they wear.
Well, they borrowed them.
At school and they had to pass them down. Yeah.
And okay, all right. Okay, that's. I mean, I like it when we're a bit divided. It makes for better viewing, doesn't it? What about Lomachenko Walters? That's a fantastic. When I seen that fight made, I was like, woo, that's a good one. Let's go down the line here. Go on.
I don't think. The backing of Lomachenko, I don't think they'd take the Walters fight if they seen it as a risk.
Okay.
Because there's so much
in the the man who's learnt his business.
That's it.
Honest to God, I just think they've watched them two, the two of them, and they've seen the way, like, even what Walters did to Nonito, and Lomachenko's a completely different fighter. The footwork is unbelievable, where Walters is...
It didn't help him much in the Salido fight, though, did it?
Diff, isn't he?
It didn't help him much in the Salido fight, did it, Lomachenko?
But then there was the came in overweight, bum rushed him. He'd only had one as a professional, was he?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Even just off that fight, he probably wouldn't be as good as he is now.
He's not had that many as a professional now, though, has he?
I know, but if he never had that loss to Salido, he probably wouldn't be the fighter he is now.
And he did look sensational in his last fight. Sensational.
Yeah. Against Rocky.
I was sat from 6 yards away from that, and I've never seen anything like that.
I've never seen anyone do that to him though either. To Rocky Martinez. Do you know what I mean?
So you're all going for Lomachenko on that one?
Yeah,
I haven't seen enough of Walters. I've seen was it the Nair fight?
Yeah,
when he burst onto the scene, and I was really impressed with Walters, but. Being honest, I've not watched one fight since. Mm. I tend to only watch the divisions I'm operating in.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't got a big stable, and it's been the 140s and 147s I've really been looking at.
Okay. All right. I'm going with Lomachenko too. Lomachenko to me is top 5 pound for pound at the minute.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
100%. Good. Just on a quick final note then here, we've got some great people to ask here. Top 5 pound for pound. I mean, everyone's going to have a slight different angle on this. Top 5 pound for pound, who are we going with? Who are we going for number one, pound for pound at the minute?
No, I'm Chocolatito all the way.
You're going Chocolatito all day, every day.
I'm going to Golovkin.
You're going to go Golovkin? One,
then Chocolatito.
Neil?
I don't know. There's about four or five, isn't there?
I'm going with Andre Ward, personally.
Well, three, I'd go Andre Ward, yeah. Four, I'd go Kokolev. Kovalev.
The names we've already discussed are Lomachenko and Golovkin.
Does Crawford sneak in there?
Crawford.
I think Crawford.
Yeah. No. I wouldn't put Crawford above all the top welterweights.
Yeah. Do you know what I mean? He's only beat... Even his world champion fights, they were all like lightweight stepping up and things like that. Okay. Like, when he moved up to light welter, who did he fight? It was someone else who was stepping up with him.
Crawford, you're talking about?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, his most notable win recently was Postal.
But Rigondo just isn't active enough, is he?
Yeah.
I love Rigondo more than most people, but...
He didn't... I mean, he was put on Frank's show, wasn't he, against Jazza.
You only seen 4 minutes of him.
Yeah, I know. It's a shame, because that could have been his coming out party, even though I obviously wanted Jazza to win. Guys, thank you so much for making the trip here to come and see us. It's been brilliant hearing from you. And seriously, everybody, get behind these guys. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you in today.
Thanks for the coverage as well.
No problem at all. And of course, thanks to John as well. This is Aki Kareem for BBTV's new weekly boxing show, Boxmania. Power.